being strengthened by you, O Lord Jesus, that we will joyfully give thanks to Christ, O Lord God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Have been patient, O Lord God, and joyfully give thanks unto you, O God, who qualified us to share in the inheritance in Christ, O Lord. Hallelujah, Lord, that you save us, that you redeem us, O Lord God, out of darkness, O Lord God, out of dominion of darkness, into marvelous light. Thank you, Lord, to redeem us, O Lord God, and for the salvation in Christ Jesus, the forgiveness of sin, O Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you for that word of God, that, Lord, that we will continue hold on steadfast in you, Lord Jesus. Bless you, O Holy Spirit, O Lord God. That, Lord, that we lift up our hands to you, Lord, and saying that, Jesus, here am I, Lord Jesus. Bring me to that place, Lord God. Break me in Jesus' name, Lord. Mold me in Jesus' name, Lord. Continue, Lord God. Do that works in me, Lord. Do that works in my life, O Lord God. That my life will bring out, Lord God, the fragrance in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord God. No longer look at our problems, our situation, but look up to God, that who is able. Look up to God, that who is able to break that stronghold. Hallelujah. That when we face that our Goliath, when we face our strong man, that Jesus, that you, O God, help us, O Lord God. Help us to be overcomers, O Lord, in Jesus' name, O Lord. Hallelujah, Lord God. Not to look at our trouble, not to look at our worries, but Jesus, to look up to you. Let, Lord, that our faith will arise, O Lord God. Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, O Lord God. Hallelujah, Lord God. The God that able to open the Red Sea is the same God who opened the door for us to serve you, to know you in the greater measure. Hallelujah, Lord. The God who able to overcome, to kill the Goliath, is the same God who gives strength to us to overcome our situation. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God. Father, we thank you for your words. Thank you for continue to hold on to us. Continue to give us that perseverance to press on, Lord God. Continue to trust in you, Lord God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord, that we will not lose hope, Lord God, in you. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Lord. Father, we pray tonight as you, O God, who lead us in worship, Lord God, that, Lord, that you reveal to us, O Lord God, of your wonders, O Lord God, tonight, that the Word of God, as you preach, O Lord God, as the preacher preach, O Lord God, that the Word of God will have power and deep conviction of the Holy Spirit that can change soul, O Lord God, and revive our spirit man, O Lord God, that to say, yes, it is you that, Lord, I have come into this place. Then I have go out no longer the same person, because God, that you have changed me, because God, that you have allowed me, O God, to know who you are, a God able to change, a God able to revive us, O Lord God. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Lord. We bless you, O God. We bless you, O Lord God. Hallelujah. Holy Spirit, thank you. Come into this place. Come into this place and fill our hearts and our soul. Hallelujah, in Jesus' name. Holy Spirit, we welcome you. Holy Spirit, we thank you, Lord God, for who you are. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Good evening, brothers and sisters. I'm very happy to see so many people in the house of the Lord tonight. As I'm preparing for the worship session tonight, Easter has just passed, which is some of us who are here, we actually watched the musical. And you know, actually, after watching the musical, I was quite touched, because it didn't occur to me that it was so difficult to preach about a dead man then. All right, it's like everyone witnessed this person died. Only that few people witnessed him being alive and he come back and tell them. And then they need to tell everybody that this man is alive and he's real. He's the Savior, he's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And then have to meet, you know, opposition, like from Saul and then Paul. And then, you know, the whole thing. And I became very grateful to the salvation that I have today. And brothers and sisters, I also want to encourage all of us to come to God and, you know, today as we worship Him, to be really thankful and grateful that salvation came upon us enough. And we're going to pray, continue to pray for salvation upon our family, our friends and the people around us. That yes, it's not easy, but it's not impossible. Right? That the gospel and the message of Christ has been shared from generation to generation, generations, thousands of years, and to us and to our future generation. So as we come and worship God today, let's come with a grateful heart to thank God for His amazing grace in our life. Amen? All right, let's rise to our feet as we sing our first song, This is Amazing Grace. Hallelujah. God, we just want to thank You. Thank You for Your amazing grace, Lord Jesus. We are thankful for You, Lord.
Stronger, the King.
God we worship today is the same God that appeared to everyone that we read before in the Bible. And this God that we worship is the God that resurrected 2,000 over years ago. Let's sing and declare the power of God, that when we sing this, we remember who our God is, that our God is the same God yesterday, today, and forever. I'm calling on the God of Jacob, whose love endures through generations. I know that you will keep your covenant. I'm calling on the God of Moses, the one who opened up the ocean. Rock of ages.
And
to break every unbelief. That God wants to say, I'm real, I'm true. I'm the same God of Jacob, the same God of David, the same God of Moses, the same God of Mary. I am your God. I am your God, your personal God. And if there is a situation in our life that we feel that is so impossible, don't know how, let's cry out to God. God is real. He has His ways. He knows what He's doing. His timing is perfect. Claim that, not the worries, but the promises. Say, I believe in you, Jesus. I believe. I believe in you. I believe. I believe. Just take this moment to respond to God and say, God, I'm calling on you. I'm counting on you. If you don't come true for me, God, I don't know how. But I'm calling on you. I'm counting on you. Come and fill me again. Come and fill me again with a new thought, a new faith, a new trust. New strength. Come and fill me again to continue this journey in you. Just take this moment to respond to God and say, God, come and fill me again. Jesus, we believe, Lord, and you freed the captives then, you are also freeing hearts right now. God, we know that hearts are being set free tonight in your name. Hearts are being set free tonight in your spirit. That God, we may not see it, but God, we know your Holy Spirit works in ways we cannot see and we cannot understand. But God, we want to proclaim and call to you. To your name, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. Please be seated.
Thank you, Stella and worship team, for leading us in this wonderful worship. Good evening, church family. Welcome to the house of God. Can you all hear me at the back? All right. So we like to thank you for all of you for coming here today, for taking your time off to spend your evenings with us. And also remembering those who are worshiping online with us, we also like to honor you. And we also want to bless you and greet you with shalom, and may the Lord's peace be upon you. So before we move on, is there anybody here with us for the very first time? Can I see a show of hands? Anybody? Okay, we have one brother here. And and then there's another one there. All right. So in case you guys didn't know, this is a church that emphasizes on the family of God, and we would like to honor you, your presence with us here today. For all our new friends, we would like to inform you that there will be a coffee corner outside Eden Hall right after the service. So if you could, after the service, kindly go to that corner so that we can get to know you more. So before we move on, why don't we just rise to our feet? Let's just look at our neighbors and greet each other with a warm welcome and a big smile. Just find our seats again. For today's announcements, we would like to inform you that our FGC Voice 29th edition has been published. So if you want to know what has been going on over the last few months in our church, when you want to know about our income, our expenditures and whatnot, and also about what the leaders of this church are thinking and their write-ups, as well as some testimonials, you feel free to grab a copy now, which you can also find online at fgc.com, fgc.org.my. Okay, and if you have some story to share with us, feel free to contact us at admin@fgc.org.my or call us at a number that I think can be found in your bulletin. Okay, and we would like to publish your story in the next edition, and we hope you will enjoy the reading this edition of FGC's Voice magazine. Next, we have our AIMS course, which is the first AIMS course for this year. So it will be held on the 20th of April. As you can see from the screen, there will be two courses. The first course will be in the morning, okay? The AIMS course, the first one will be titled Prayer, How to be Heard in Heaven. And it will be from 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. So the fee is just 5 ringgit, and the deadline to sign up would be tomorrow, okay? And the next course in the afternoon, it's titled Fasting for Spiritual Breakthrough. It's for the English, it's English only. And the speakers for both these courses will be Timothy Lam. Okay, and the deadline is of course tomorrow as well. And both these courses will cost 5 ringgit each. So for just 10 ringgit, you can sign up for two courses. I don't know where else you can find such a low fee for two courses in a single day. So tomorrow is the deadline. Remember this and just sign up if you can. Okay? And if you can't, you can also register through the link in the e-bulletin or register at the counter right after the service. Next, we have our Father's School Malaysia promotion. Okay? I will invite Brother Victor Low to come on the stage to introduce this.
And sisters in Christ, can you hear me? Okay, my name is Victor Low. I come to Sunday's service most of the time, and I probably say this is the first time that I'm attending the Saturday service. So I've been here in this church for 15 years. Probably I would have been away, right, for at least 5 years in China and 3 years in the MCO, so COVID time. So at least 8 years I am not in this church. So all in could be 7 years, and probably you have not seen me very, very often. Okay, if I see you, probably I know you. If you don't see me, I do not know you. Okay, simple as that. Okay. Just now, I just talked about my background, right? And now, I want to share my testimony of attending Father's School. I have a lovely wife and 2 grown-up adult sons. I'm standing here to share why I joined Father's School and encourage every father, old and young, or even grandpa, father to be pre-marriage man in our church to join. Before I joined Father's School, I was quite egoistic and proud to be a father. Why I say that? Because both my sons are doctors, and considering I have done pretty well in my role as a father and excel in parenting journey. My elder one is an aesthetic doctor now, while my younger one is an MO in one of the government hospital in JB. So now, I have this thought in my mind of making decisions similar to you. I will refer to the good guy, okay, and the bad guy syndrome. Example, the good guy will say, I want to go to Father's School. The bad guy will say, why do you want to go to Father's School? Both your sons are doing well and they are doctors. In terms of parenting, you have done a great job as a father. Then the good guy will say, it's me, No, I am a Christian and I still believe a lot of things to be learned. Yeah? So, and when I approach some people, they were like me. No offense to anyone here. We can be egoistic and proud of ourselves as a father in our parenting journey, but we can't be proud in front of our Father. Who is He? Our Father in heaven. Okay? Now, I would like to encourage all our fathers to come to attend this Father's School. Regardless of how long you have become a Christian, and you should not stop learning. Do come. Learn new knowledge, a touch of God, and a fatherly experience that will be conducted in the Father's School. I believe all the fathers who have attended the course, it has benefited them. By which fostering and unleashing your utmost important role, being a father. Just like me, doesn't mean that I have no communication problems with my 2 adult sons, who are doctors nowadays. With the Father's School, I start to relearn. Okay? And learn it, be respectful, and be humble. This has helped me to remind myself and to hone my parenting skills, especially applying godly, biblical principles with our children. Perhaps I could say my communication with them has tremendously improved. If I have benefited from it, surely you will also be benefited. Fill yourself with fatherly joy, okay? Again, as it was with you. We also do not want the cause with you. We also do not all the sisters. God created us a man and a woman. A man and a woman as a couple as husband and wife, with one body, one unity, one mind, love enveloped. Later, we have our children. We learn to love each other and extend our love by providing a good parenting care to our children. In the journey, there are obstacles and challenges ahead in our Christian walk and as well as in our home. Yeah? As a man of the house of the highest calling, we hold responsibility to our wives and children. In Father's School, we also touch on the love relationship to instill utmost respect and harmony within a married couple too. For sisters or wife, don't you want to see your man or the husband transformation cultivated and taught in the Father's School? Due to time, my takeaway and last few words to wrap up. Please come to Father's School to enroll, especially the men. You will not be disappointed. I see many happy faces here. I just now was shaking hands too. And happy families here. I'm not sure. Maybe you have something in the back of your mind. Pour it out, especially men. Do come enroll in Father School. For the wives or sisters here, encourage and motivate your husbands or men to join the Father School. Our Father School course is very near to commence soon, and I encourage you all to attend it. Once again, thank you and looking forward to your participation. So after this, when the church service is over, we'll be behind, and you want to fill up, we'll fill up the form for you straight away, yeah, for the fathers. And the wives, please encourage and push the men to really, really join the Father School. Thank you so much. Bye. See you later.
Thank you, Brother Victor, for this inspirational speech. As you can see from our decoration around here, how many of you know how much work was put into the decoration for our Easter musical? Please do not put up your hands. Yeah. So if you all didn't know, we had our Easter musical around 2 weeks ago, and we would like to show you the highlights of this video so that you can see how much effort was put in for the glory of God. Can we have the video? Can we have another round of applause for everyone who put so much effort into making our first musical a huge, huge success? Okay? And if you guys didn't know, today is actually the last week to buy the t-shirt. So if you still want it, you can go to the ground floor and where the musical banner is and get your t-shirt. This is the last week, the last call. So do not regret if you don't buy it. Okay? And for the final thing today, which is also one of the most important, baby dedications will happen now. So to this year, we have 19 babies who are being dedicated, and 8 of them, okay, are here with us today. So as I call the names, can you just please, parents of the babies, stand up, because obviously the babies can't stand up by themselves. And just stand up and come to the front so that we can praise and honor you. Okay? So, first we have Aiden Ezra, okay, the son of Anderson Bryan and Esther Jesudas. Can you stand and come to the front? Thanks. And next we have Adrian Daniel. Okay. He is the son of Augustus Rentap and Annalyn Ampat Belisario. Then we have Emma Wong Lee Han, the daughter of Fu Yao and Wen Jun. Then we have Clara Chandra Pillay, who is the daughter of Caleb Chandra Pillay and Wei Han. And then next we have Emma Goh, the daughter of Jin Heng and Pei Yin. Then we have Noah, who is the son of Ivan Tan Ren Chong and Olivia Peter Kun. Next we have Noel Pang Jayu, who is the son of Wei Sun and Sweet Yin. And last but not least, we have Baby Ray, who is the daughter of Joshua and Karina. So can I invite Brother James to come on stage and bless the babies and also commemorate?
Yeah.
Asian.
What an exciting time to have so many children, young children in our midst. You know, the first commandment that God gave was to be fruitful and multiply. And all these parents here responded. And God gave us a wonderful gift. The Bible tells us that children are gifts from the Lord. And then the Bible tells us that we must train up the child in the way he should go, so that when he grows old, he will not depart from it. And so as parents, sometimes we have this daunting task of bringing up our children. That's why we need the Father's School to help us. But we also need help from God. Yeah. And so we got to do a dedication. And this is a threefold dedication. The first dedication is a dedication by the parents of their children to God. And say, God, you have given to me, now I give them back to you. The second dedication is a dedication of the parents. And say, God, we know all these parents, they want to bring their children up in the way of the Lord, but it is so tough. We want to dedicate the parents so that the parents will be blessed. The parents will have strength and wisdom from God. And the third dedication, we're going to dedicate all of you. Because we are a church family. And in this family, the children will find a place of joy, a place of comfort, a place where they're safe to grow up to become more and more like Jesus. So shall we all stand? Let's stand and stretch out our hands to the front and pray for them. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we want to give thanks and praise to you and to pray for all these young children, every one of them. They are all precious to you. They are all special to you. And Father, we just want to thank you for every one of these child. On behalf of the parents, I just want to rededicate these children to you, because you have given to us as gifts. And these gifts are so precious that we want to give what is most important and most precious to you, because you are God and you're worthy of all our giving. Father, we also want to pray for all the parents. Lord, you know our struggles. You know our challenges. You know how inadequate we are. Without you, we are nothing. Without you, it is impossible for us to be good parents. It is even more impossible to be great parents. And so, God, I pray that you come and help every one of these parents, both the father and the mother, to have the wisdom that comes from you, to speak your words into their lives and to guide these children as they grow up. And Father, we want to dedicate ourselves as members of this Christian family. Father, these two are our children. We are their uncles and aunties. And Father, together as a family, we want to see these children growing up, worshipping, honoring your name, that as they grow older, they'll become more and more like you. Thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's give a clap to God and give a clap to these wonderful parents and children. Thank you very much. Thank you. Please be seated.
Brother James, for the dedication, please remain on stage to give the sermon. Please welcome Brother James. Thank you.
Good evening to all of you. So glad to be able to come and share with you the Word of God. You know, this book, The Top 5 Regrets of Dying, is written by a lady called Bronnie Ware from Australia. She's a nurse that has spent several years working in palliative care, caring for patients in the last 12 weeks of their lives. As a result of her interactions with them, she has written this book, The Top 5. And out of these five, at least two of them has something to do with relationship. The first one is, I wish I hadn't worked so hard. And the reason why the dying person wishes that he or she has not worked so hard is so that they can spend more time with their family. Another one is, I wish I'd stayed in touch with my friends. And this is also about relationship. And so out of the five top regrets, two of them has to do with relationships. So when time is short, people want to spend time building relationships. And the interesting thing is that God is already aware of them, because He's the one who created us. He's the one who made us that way, wanting to have deeper and better relationship. And we see this in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 7 to 8. It says, the end of all things is near. Therefore, be clear-minded and self-controlled, so that you may pray. Above all, love each other deeply, because love covers over a multitude of sin. Verse 7, he says, the end of all things is at hand. It presents a different kind of terminus than the one who is dying, but it's a terminus nevertheless. The context of what we are going to look at subsequent to this is that the end of all things is near. Things end when Jesus Christ comes again. This end is a bit different from the end of dying, because the end of dying varies from person to person. And if our end is due to death, then we can say those who are older will more likely die first. People like myself will go first. But some of you are younger, and especially the little babies that we dedicate together today will have a longer life. They will still have a longer journey. But the coming of Jesus will bring an end to this earth, and it is sudden. We do not know when that is going to happen. And it will bring an end to this earth altogether at the same time. It will affect every one of us. And so, the only time we have is now. And because of this shortness of time, and because this is all that we have, what are we supposed to do? What should we do as believers? And so in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 8, it says, above all, the most important thing that we should do is to love each other deeply. A few weeks ago, I was here preaching from Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23, and in that verse, it says, above all else. Looks like we are focusing on the things that God wants us to do, things that are truly and really important. So the title of my message tonight is Love Each Other Deeply. You recognize the people inside? I've purposely chosen this picture because loving each other deeply is not done in isolation. It is not done in a vacuum. Loving each other deeply is practiced in times of multiple interactions and under intense pressure. When we bump into one another, when we step on one another's toes, when we rub shoulders with one another, it is in these kind of situations that we need to love one another deeply. So we're going to look at this verse again. There are several things I want to talk about this phrase, above all, love each other deeply. First of all, the emphasis, above all, more important than anything else. If there's 101 thing you must do, make sure you do this one thing if it is inside. That is to love each other. This is the most important thing for us to do if we have time. We must love each other. Can you tell the person next to you, love each other? Secondly, it refers to love between believers. It is not just any each other. This is meant to be practiced in the community of the believers. This is meant to be practiced in the church. John chapter 13, verse 34 and 35 says, a new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you. So you must love one another. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. We all know that we have two great commandments. What are two great commandments? Love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Number two, love your neighbor as ourselves. That's love God and love people. But why is it that moments before his death, Jesus told his disciples, I give you a new commandment, love one another. How is this different from loving your neighbor as yourself? Loving your neighbor as yourself is loving the people in general. But to love one another in the context of what Jesus or the people Jesus was speaking to, Jesus was speaking to the disciples. And when Jesus died and resurrected, the church was born. And as a result, we have a new platform. How are we supposed to treat one another in this new platform? The new platform needs a new modus operandi. The new platform needs a new principle. A new platform needs a new practice. And that new practice is that as believers, as members of the same household, we are supposed to love one another. And the Bible says, if we love one another, people will know that we are believers. We are going to be believers. And so love should be our trademark. And the third thing that I want to emphasize here is, we are supposed to love each other. Who is this commandment given to? When I say, love each other, who is supposed to do the loving? Everyone who hears this commandment is supposed to respond. Everyone who hears this commandment is the one that is supposed to love. A lot of time when we hear commandments like this, love each other, and then you say, yes, amen. Now I'm waiting for people to love me. We think of ourselves as the object rather than thinking of ourselves as the subject. But here, the Bible is telling us we are the ones. Jesus wants us. Jesus commands us. And we must respond to that command by loving each other. To love and not wait to be loved. We are producers, not just consumers. If everyone is a consumer and no one is a producer, soon there'll be nothing left to consume. So ask yourselves today, are you a producer or are you a consumer? Jesus is telling us, all of us must be producers of love. So now you tell the person next to you, I want to love you. Do it sincerely. Even if you come to the person and they have a quarrel before this, just say, I want to love you. I do not know how, but I choose to love you. And how are we supposed to love one another? The Bible tells us that we are supposed to love one another deeply. Deeply means not superficially. And this idea of loving one another deeply is part of the ethos in 1 Peter. It is part of the value of Peter, because earlier on in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 22, this idea of loving one another deeply is already mentioned. Now that you have purified yourselves by obeying the truth so that you have sincere love for your brothers, love one another. Think of loving one another deeply. It means that we cannot just love them with our lips. We must also not love them just with our action. We must love them with our heart. A lot of us, we think that I should not love with lips, but I need to love with action. I'm telling you, love with action also not enough. You must love with your heart. Presented, manifested through action. We'll look a bit more at that. And it's interestingly, this word deeply is translated in many ways in different versions. In ESV, it means earnestly. In New King James Version, it is fervent. In the Holman Bible, it's intense. In the Aramaic English Bible, it's severe. In CEV, it's sincerely. In GWT, it's warmly. And so what we're supposed to do is that we're supposed to love one another deeply, earnestly, fervently, intensely, severely, sincerely, warmly. Wow. I think when you experience that kind of love, you go, oh, oh, oh. You get electrocuted. You feel the warmth, you feel the fire. You know, this is love. Last night, we had the Alpha course. And we had one of the Alpha workers who came and visit us. And they subsequently gave a feedback. He said, this is one of the best Alpha course that he has attended. And he says that because from the moment I came, I felt welcome. All the new friends are welcome. That's what we should do. Let them feel our love. So how to love one another deeply? Chapter 4, verse 8. Above all, love each other deeply because love covers over a multitude of sin. Not one sin, not some sins, but multitude of sins. I was thinking about this. I said, God, you are speaking to a church and you are telling believers that they are supposed to love one another deeply. And the reason why these people need to love one another deeply, because there's multitudes of sins to be forgiven. The reason why I feel that it doesn't make sense is because we are all believers, ma, correct? As believers, we must have the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. We are supposed to treat one another, love one another well. How to have so many sins? Actually, there is a lot. It's just that we don't want to face them, we don't want to deal with them. We pretend we do not know about them. Definitely, we have multitude of sins. And you know the idea of multitude? Multitude is a lot, no? So I did a study on this word multitude and realized that this word, same word multitude, is repeated in Acts chapter 2, verse 6. The multitude gathered together to listen to Peter preach. How many people do you think they were in that multitude? Subsequently, after Peter finished preaching, gave the altar call, how many people got saved? 3,000 people got saved. Which means multitude, it's at least 3,000 people. Maybe it's 6,000. Maybe it's 30,000. We don't know. But the multitude gathered and 3,000 got saved. So multitude means at least 3,000. Can you imagine there's 3,000 sins in church? Can la. I sin against Lai. I sin against Joanne. That's two already. Maybe I do something. I offended everyone. One act offended maybe 200, 300 people. So you gather together, there's a lot. And the Bible tells us we must have that kind of love. Because if we don't have that kind of love, the sin would remain. And when that sin remains, it will break down relationships. One day, Peter was very confident and went to Jesus. Jesus, how many times must I forgive my brother? Then this fella, too much, you know. He asked a question, and before Jesus can answer, he answered himself. And he answered himself with another question. Jesus, how many times must I forgive my brethren? Seven times? You see, the Jewish practice is you forgive up to three times. And so he thought, I've done it. I've progressed. Now, after following Jesus, I can forgive up to seven times. 3 plus 3 plus 1, 7. I didn't expect Jesus to come back very quickly with a reply. Not 7, but 70 times 7. That is like 490 times. And the reason why Jesus said that, the interest is not so much in the number, but to give such a big number to remind us that we must forgive all sins. We must never bear any grudges. And so if we love one another deeply, our love will be demonstrated through forgiveness and acceptance that we can forgive and accept everyone. Amen? We can forgive every person and we can accept every person no matter how difficult it is. The reason why we have multitude of sin is very simple because all of us are imperfect. Let me just check. Maybe some of you have reached nirvana. None of us are perfect, correct? And we are imperfect, we will still make mistakes. And the more we serve together, like those kind of production earlier on, so intense, so busy, so compacted, surely it stresses us. Surely there's tremendous pressure. Surely our fuse become shorter. And we make mistakes. And what do? Do we just avoid? If you don't deal with it, what will happen is because of these mistakes, because of these offenses, it will gather and it will build up a wall. And as a result, we'll start to distance ourselves. And then maybe next year we do another Easter. Yeah, let other people join. I don't want to join. That's what will happen. And so we need to love one another deeply so that we can show forgiveness and acceptance. Secondly, we need to love through hospitality, but without grumbling. He says, above all, love each other deeply because love covers over a multitude of sin. And verse 9 says, offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. Offering hospitality is not just the work of the ushers. Offering hospitality is our work. Every one of us is supposed to be off. This hospitality needs to be extended to members as well as to visitors. It's our duty towards each other. How do we offer hospitality? Just offhand, giving way to people. Later on, you come out, we have a big hall, we have a small door. Giving way to one another is hospitality. It's showing courtesy. When people come in, we welcome them. When the when the chairman introduced those who are here with us for the first time, we clap for them. We greet one another, we smile at each other. All these are external. We can do all this hospitality. And while we are smiling, while we are shaking hands, and then in our heart we can be thinking, why are you here? We grumble. We are not happy. You know, grumbling is a very important test, and it is significant in our life. Philippians chapter 2, verse 14 and 15 say, do everything without complaining, without grumbling. It's the same Greek word, complaining or grumbling, or arguing, so that you may become blameless and pure, children of God, without fault, in a crooked and depraved generation in which you shine like stars in the universe. You know, brothers and sisters, the moment we can reach this acme of not grumbling, we can reach this peak of not arguing, the Bible tells us we are perfect. So you know how you can be perfect? You don't need people to tell you. The moment you stop arguing, the moment you stop grumbling, you're already perfect. How many of you want to be perfect? You see, when you offer hospitality, it is love in action with your lips, with your hands, with your body. But Jesus is saying, or Paul is saying, Peter is saying, that's not enough. You must do it without grumbling. That's why to love one another deeply has to come from the heart. A lot of us, when we grumble, we don't have to grumble aloud. We just have to grumble inside. Why? You know, like the Easter. Why so much practice? Why practice so late? Why the food cold already? Why have so many sessions? Why don't do in the sanctuary? Why do here? Why? I'm not saying that the Easter program got a lot of problem, but no. It's just because it's very recent and then show you the video, it becomes a very convenient illustration. We can have a lot of why. And the more you ask why, the more unhappy you become. Inside unhappy, but your face need to show happy. Welcome. So nice. So many practices. Yay! The inside and the outside doesn't synchronize. I realize one thing in so many years of service. When the inside and the outside doesn't synchronize, it becomes pressure. It becomes stress. It's like the inside and the outside go separate direction. Go together, same direction. You hold hand. you pat tall. You're like going out on a date. But if inside and outside is different direction, you're pulling against one another. There's a lot of stress. And so the Bible is telling us we need to love. We need to love through hospitality by doing good to people. But when you do good, you cannot grumble. You must be cheerful. You must be happy. You must be delighted. Instead of grumbling and complaining, we need to compliment. We need to praise. We also need to love through serving with our gifts. Verse 10 says, each one should use whatever gift he has received to serve others. Each one of us is gifted for the common good. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 7 and to 12 says, but to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it to prepare God's people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up. The reason why God has given every one of us gifts, and the reason why He has given us gifts, is not a safe deposit box. It's not for us to keep it at home, but it's meant for us to use. To use it in order to be a blessing to others. You have, you share. And the very interesting thing is that all of us are gifted. So everyone is important and useful. You are gifted, therefore you are also wanted. And remember, you're wanted to serve, not to be served. Even the Son of Man, the Bible tells us, came to serve. Jesus came to serve. What did you come to do? We must also come to serve. You know, I begin to understand how important every part of the body is and how important it is for all the parts to come together. And the Bible tells us earlier on in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 12, it says that when each part does its work, the body of Christ will be built up. You all know that recently I had this gas explosion that I went through already quite a few months ago. There's this part of the story that I haven't told. You know, in the morning, the next day after I was in the hospital, in the morning, I had to go to the toilet. And so I managed to get in. I sat on the toilet bowl and I cracked the toilet seat. You all remember that part. Then it was time for serious business. Every morning, I have this habit of going to the toilet and pass out my motion. And I sat there trying to pass out my motion. And you know what? How do you do it? You have to exert, right? Exert strength on your bowels. You have to constrict your muscle, maybe towards the anal portion, and then you try to push it out. And I did, with all my strength. And the moment I did it, you know what happened? Suddenly, I felt a sharp pain in both my calf. Because it was already injured. The burns was from my knee downwards. And I felt a sharp pain in my calf. So quickly, I relaxed. Then I try again, and the pain was in the calf. And then I try again. The pain was in the calf. Then, you know, end up how I do. Push, relax, push, relax, push, relax, push, relax. I suddenly felt like I was a pregnant woman trying to give birth. I may be fat, but I'm not pregnant. I push, let go. I tell you, I'm 59 years old this year, soon. Only this year, or only last year, end of last year, I realized that you need your calf muscles in order to bear up. I'm sure it was there. It was working all the time. But I did not know. So brothers and sisters, just now we see all the people, dance, shake, henna, this, that, in the Easter show. But do you know, in order to make it happen, there were a lot of people that works behind the scene. You come in and you see, praise and worship, musician, got preacher, got chairman. Do you know that in order to get this place ready every week, there are a lot of people who works behind the scene. Look at all this. You need people at the booth. You need people to do the miniature. You need all these makeup artists, props. So much work. You are needed. You are wanted. You are important. we need to love deeply. And how do we love deeply? We love deeply through showing forgiveness and acceptance. That helps us to remove all the negative of the past. Past hurts, past pain, past bitterness. And then we need to love through hospitality without grumbling. It removes all the negative actions, all the negative motivation in our good work. And then we need to love through serving with our gifts. That will be our positive contribution to help build up the church. If we do this, surely we'll strengthen the relationships in the church and build up the church. But is it easy to love each other deeply? Hard, right? That's why there's multitudes of sin. But thank God, God is available for us. Verse 11 says, if anyone speaks, he should do it as one speaking the very words of God. If anyone serves, he should do it with the strength that God provides. God will provide strength to us. God will provide us the strength. God will provide the resources that you need to love and also serve. Romans chapter 5, verse 8, but God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. 1 John chapter 4, verse 19 says, we love because he first loved us. And so when you think you're running out of love, come to God. Let God refill you with his love. Sometimes you'll run out. Sometimes you'll feel exhausted. Sometimes get so upset. I cannot love him anymore. It's impossible. But come to God and learn from Jesus. While we were yet sinners, he died for us. While we were having this multitude of sins, he showed his love by dying for us. He gave us his forgiveness. He gave us his acceptance. So come to Jesus. Sometimes in the midst of our serving, it is so tough. We don't have any problem with people, but the serving itself is difficult. I remember David was the high priest. But he's a natural. He don't have to put in much effort. He really looks like one and sounds like one. That day when he was in the show, we were very afraid that he would spoil the mic and break our speakers. Because it's so loud! I put in a lot of effort just to do that, and he does it naturally. But if you have difficulty doing this ministry that God has given to you, know that God is there for you. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 7, the end of all things is near. Therefore, be clear-minded and self-controlled so that you can pray. Peter is telling them, be clear-minded and self-controlled. You know why? Because a few verses early on in verse 3 talks about their past. How they were involved in sexual sins. How they had no control over their lives and they were constantly drunk. Now that believe in Jesus, they say, now you better sober up. Have a clear mind. Pray. In prayer, we connect with God. In prayer, we can receive the strength and the wisdom from God to serve him faithfully and effectively. Amen. We cannot, but God can. We don't know, but God knows. So brothers and sisters, let us love each other deeply. Amen. Let us love each other, showing them forgiveness and acceptance. Let us love each other by offering hospitality without grumbling. Let us love each other by using the gifts that God has given to us to serve one another. And in that way, we will surely build relationships. The reason why I chose to preach on this passage and this message today was last month, the staff got together and prayed. And we felt that one of the most important things we have to do as a church is to make the church a loving community, build relationships. Build relationships because we are supposed to love our neighbor as ourselves, because we are supposed to love one another the same way that Christ has loved us. Because by this shall all men know that we are God's disciples. This is the trademark of the church. This is the trademark of God's people. And so let us make this a loving community. And it takes more than just the usher. It takes every one of us to acknowledge the people around us, to smile at them, to welcome them, to embrace them into this Christian family. Amen. Let's do it together. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we just want to give thanks and praise to you. Lord, we are so excited. Lord, we want to thank you for all the new life that you have brought into the church. All the babies, all the toddlers that we dedicated today. Father, we believe that many more people will come in because they need to know you as Lord and Savior. And Father, I pray that as a church, as a congregation, we'll make it easy for them. That as they walk in, they'll be welcome. As they walk in, they'll be embraced. As they walk in, they'll be loved. They'll be accepted, regardless of who they are and what they've done. Our role, our duty is love them. Father, we pray, O God, that we'll become a place for those who do not yet know you to find you, to know you and to grow in you. Thank you, Jesus. Father, and especially pray for all my brothers and sisters who may be physically unwell. Let your anointing come upon them right now. Let your healing power flow through them. Let them be healed in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a great weekend. Remember, you can go and sign up for the Father's course, and it goes to all grandfathers, fathers, and also fathers-to-be. God bless you. So if you have any needs for prayer, do come to the front. We'd love to pray with you. It's our privilege to do so. Thank you.